cross section of the indicated work or power produced by the IC engine. Varying from this friction work or friction power, this is 10% at full load to 100% at idle or no load. In case of idle RPM, the engine produces power just sufficient to overcome the frictional loss so that the crankshaft just rotates and the components like piston that moves up and down and a connecting rod, you know, that just oscillates. So ideally we say that friction work or friction power is 100% at idle RPM or no load, and that is maximum is 10% at full load. That means, you know, the corresponding frictional power in case of IC engine at full load means full power. Full power means, if you take the example of a Maruti Suzuki 800cc car engine, which produces a power of 39.5 bhp at 5500 rpm, 10% of 39.5 bhp could mean 3.95 bhp is the frictional power. Okay, that means at the rated speed of the full load, corresponding to full load, often the difference between a good engine design and an average engine design is the difference in the frictional losses. So in case of the engine design, when we want to design engine in a better manner for more power, for higher power, for higher torque, for a lower BSFC, for a better mileage, for lower emissions, the same could be achieved by one more method, that is by decreasing the frictional power or frictional work that the engine has to do, you know, as that the engine has to do some work against friction, or the engine has to overcome the frictional power. Somebody could be there. Let us see.
Yes, sir.
So we are here. People who work at a doctorate level or a research level, and maybe a postdoctorate level, what area you could work? This is also one of the areas, you know, where you could possibly reduce the corresponding frictional power or the work that the engine has to, in order to overcome the frictional loss. You know, that will also boost the power of the engine, torque of the engine. The BSFC will be lowered, the mileage will be increased, and you know, somehow, you know, this may or may not be covering the emissions, because this is basically, you know, a performance parameter. When you talk of power, you know, power as such, or you talk of load, that costs on the performance. This does not cost on the emissions. But when you could increase the power, you know, that means corresponding emissions per unit power output, you know, that will decrease. If you normalize the corresponding emissions per unit power output, that way it will come down. A large part of the frictional losses appear as heat. Wherever there is friction, you know, that ultimately gets converted into heat energy, and that is taken by the coolant and oil, that is lubricating oil, which must be removed in the radiator and oil cooling system. For a large power generation, you know, for large power generation like power plants, diesel generators or diesel generating sets, some large power plants which could be based on diesel, you know, there could be oil cooling system as well. Thus, frictional losses influence the size of the cooling system. There are two cooling systems. One is the coolant based, which cools the engine components. Second is how to remove the heat from the lubricating oil. You know, in countries like Saudi Arabia, you know, if they could be having petroleum based power plants, you know, are running almost non-stop around the clock, then you know, such cooling systems could be essential part of the diesel engine based power plants, are known as diesel generating sets. Then friction work or friction power, this includes these components. One, this includes to draw the fresh mixture through the intake system and into the cylinder, and expel the burnt gases from the cylinder and out of the exhaust. That means the intake process and the exhaust process are defined as part of the frictional work. Because please off your mics. Whosoever is having a mic, you know, you please switch off your mic. To draw the friction work or frictional power, as per the definition given by John B. Haywood, this does include the gas exchange part. Gas exchange means bringing fresh charge or air only into the engine cylinder and removing the burn gases out of the engine cylinder, out of the exhaust gas manifold. This is also considered as part of the frictional work. This part of the frictional work is known as pumping work. Pumping work means pumping air into the cylinder and pumping exhaust gas out of the cylinder. This part of the frictional work is known as pumping work. And because of this pumping work, what we can do is we can design the intake manifold and exhaust gas manifold for corresponding length of the pipes, for corresponding diameters of the pipes. Also, we can design simultaneously the gas exchange part of the engine, which basically is known as pumping work, and that's a part of the engine friction work. This helps us to design the manifolds with corresponding length of the pipes, diameter of the pipes. Lower the length of pipe, better the volumetric efficiency. Higher the diameter of the pipes, better the volumetric efficiency. Then also valve design. Valve train design does include the diameter of the valves, then valve timing, then valve overlap. There is so much optimization. So much design is involved. Dynamics is involved. The fluid flow or the air flow or exhaust gas flow is getting involved. This is not arbitrary. This is not arbitrary. In order to we were talking about how to control the friction work, how to bring it down, so that the overall performance of the engine could be increased from the friction point of view. So you can change the valve timing, we can change the valve timing, and then you can change the valve overlap, the diameters of the valves, the number of valves. Sometimes you could see written 12 valve engine on some vehicles. That means if that is a three cylinder engine, 12 valve means four valves per cylinder. Four valves per cylinder could mean two intake valves and two exhaust valves. This is highly complex, this is highly complex. At this stage, we are just at BTEC level, we are trying to know the components getting involved and the corresponding design that we have to understand. Then second component of the friction work, to overcome the resistance to the relative motion of all the moving parts of the engine. Then second component is what we otherwise know is friction. Friction we otherwise know when there is a relative motion between any two parts like piston and cylinder, or more closely, piston rings and cylinder, that is known as friction. This includes the friction between the piston rings, piston skirt, and the cylinder wall. Wherever there is contact, the contact could be between the piston rings and cylinder wall. The skirt may or may not be in contact with the cylinder wall. That is there. Friction in the wrist pin, then apart from this, first we have cylinder and piston. Then from the piston to the crankshaft, we have connecting rod. Then connecting rod has two ends, one with a piston, that is known as small end. The small end has wrist pin or a small end, that is known as small end, or the small end of the connecting rod has a pin or a bearing known as wrist pin. Then big end of the connecting rod has one more bearing known as big end bearing. This is a small end bearing, this is big end bearing. The small end bearing on the small side of the connecting rod connected with the piston, then big end bearing on the bigger side of the connecting rod connected to the crankshaft. Then crankshaft itself supported on many main bearings. The friction corresponding to so many main bearings, the minimum two number of main bearings, one on right side of the crankshaft, one on the left hand side of the crankshaft. If there is a single cylinder engine, then there could be minimum a pair of bearings, main bearings for supporting the crankshaft. One on the right hand side of the crankshaft and other on the left hand side of the crankshaft. Then these two main bearings for the crankshaft, for supporting the crankshaft, they are mounted on the chassis of the vehicle. And then there is one more shaft which is camshaft. The camshaft bearings are also there. Every shaft which rotates, that is given support by a component known as bearing, so that it does rotate, it does transfer torque or motion, and simultaneously, why bearing? Because the corresponding friction in the bearings is minimum. And if there is any variant here, that could be in the bearings only. The bearings could be an inferior material based, as compared to the crankshaft itself, as compared to a connecting rod, as compared to piston. So that in case of the maintenance, these cheaper material based components like bearings could be replaced. And this could maximize the life of the important components or costlier components. Then, you know, this was this this we have started from the piston, then piston rings, then cylinder valve, then after piston we have a connecting rod, small end of the connecting rod, small end bearing, big end of the connecting rod, big end bearing. This also is a bearing. This also a bearing. Then crankshaft, which is supported in minimum pair of main bearings or a minimum number of main bearings for multi cylinder engines. Then there is one more camshaft which will activate this valve mechanism. The camshaft is used there for activating the valve mechanism. Then because you know because camshaft is also a shaft, it also has bearings for supporting as well as allow it should support the shaft and it should allow the rotation of the shaft itself. Then friction in the valve mechanism. You know, the valve mechanism is here. How to push the valves inside and how to bring them back. You know, there's a proper mechanism. You know, like cam and follower base. The camshaft. The name is you know, the name is here. Cam and shaft. This camshaft has a cam. This cam has a follower which is used to push the valves into the cylinder, into the clearance volume, so that it opens the space for gas exchange. And then you know the spring loaded valve could return back. Automatically, cam and shaft means camshaft. This cam has a follower which pushes this valve so that it opens the intake port and exhaust port, or it closes the intake port or the exhaust port. For bringing the valve back, there's a spring. That means you know it is spring loaded. You have a pressure cookers, rice cookers like pressure cookers in your kitchens. There's a dead weight safety bell at the top. When the pressure of the steam increases, it lifts and releases the steam to the atmosphere. After the there is a balance of the pressures, you know, overall pressures on the two sides. Because of dead weight, you know, it comes down automatically. That is one method. In case of these valves, you know, there is a spring, you know, that should bring it back. Like electronic fuel injectors or magnetic injectors and solvent injectors, there also is a spring. You know, we say that these are spring loaded devices. The spring itself has, you know, can create a certain force or pressure, you know, to close the valve as tight as possible. You know, they are supposed to be leak-proof valves, but you know, they are opened and closed by cam and follower mechanism there. Then, in addition to this, the friction in the at the small end of the connecting rod, big end of the connecting rod, main bearings of the crankshaft, then the bearings of the camshaft, then in the valve activity mechanism. We have the friction in gears or pulleys and beds, which drive the camshaft. You know, in order to transfer power from the crankshaft to the camshaft, we may be having bed drives, we may be having gear drives, or any other drive. You know? Sometimes you could be seeing the chain drive in case of the motorcycles. You know, previously I could see motorcycles with chain drives. I don't remember. It could be still there. You know, how to transfer power from the crankshaft to the engine. Being used in motorcycles to the rear wheel. If the chain is still there, you know, this could be there could be that means the chain drive basically. What drive we have is friction in the gears or pulleys and beds. Pulleys and beds is you know, one mechanism. Pulleys and beds. Gear is separate. You know, gear is separate. There could be pair of gears, one on the crankshaft and one on the camshaft. Then there could be two pulleys, one on this, and the connected by a bed. We drive the camshaft and engine accessories are there. You know, what are those engine accessories? To drive the engine accessories, these could include the fan, the water pump. The fan is there, you know, the at the radiator. The water pump is there for circulation of water through the pipes of the in the cooling system, overall cooling system of the engine, which does include the radiator also. The oil pump for circulation of the lubricating oil. The fuel pump for supplying the fuel. The generator or alternator is there. The generator or alternator also gets its power from the crankshaft only. Then there could be a secondary air pump for emission control. You know? In order to control the emissions, there could be one more pump which will supply more amount of air. You know? More amount of air means how we possibly could make the mixture leaner or how we could convert the gases to safer gases. Then for things like power steering also, you know, we could be having, those devices. This is also an accessory, you know, this is also an accessory, which will contribute for the engine friction. That means, you know, in case of power steering, you know, some drive is needed. we are talking of drives. You know? We are talking of drives. Some drives, gear is also a drive. Gear drive is also a drive. Belt and pulleys is also a drive. A chain drive is also a drive. Some drives are there to run the accessories. And one of these accessories is the power steering itself. And air conditioner could be there. You know, in air conditioner, just like, you know, so for example, you have a refrigerator in your kitchen, you know, there's a compressor, you know, if there's a compressor, if you say a compressor is a mechanical component, then there's a motor. You know. If the motor is directly coupled with the compressor, that means, you know, there is a flexible coupling, may not be a rigid coupling. Sometimes when they are near, there could be a simply coupling could be there. But if they are far away, there could be a different drive. If they are very near, could be gear drive. If they are more far away, could be pulley and belt drive. If they are more far away, could be a chain drive, chain and sprocket drive could be there, you know. All these types of drives, which are used to run the accessories, apart from the friction in various components of the engine, including the valve activating mechanism, which have a relative motion between them. You know, the relative motion is there. That means, you know, they rub against each other, or they have some sort of motion with respect to each other, you know, any type of motion with respect to each other, and they are in contact with each other. They are in contact with each other, but there is a relative motion between each other. So many components, including the valve activating mechanism based components, then including the drives, you know, which does include the gear drive, which does include the belts and pulleys, which does include the chain and sprocket drives, then things like cam and follower type of things, you know, this also a mechanism. This is basically a mechanism for used for activating the valves there. So friction is in all these components, you know, this friction, which basically we started from here, we said under full load operation of the engine, the total frictional power is 10%. The absolute value of total friction work varies with load and increases as speed increases. That means the friction as such, you know, is not same over the entire range of load, over the entire range of speed. This friction work or friction power, you know, this changes from load to load. This also changes from speed to speed. So it varies with the change in the speed of the engine. It also varies with respect to load on the engine. Then corresponding with the thermodynamics being applied to IC engines, we have a certain models, you know, how to calculate the engine friction. Say for SI engines, the total motor friction, mean relative pressure. Friction we are trying to, you know, calculate basically by a computational method. This is thermodynamic modeling, you know, the equation is there. Corresponding speed N of the engine, which could be put here, and is engine speed in RPM for SI engine, we are able to measure, you know, calculate basically total, you know, frictional mean effective pressure, you know, friction in terms of the units meant for mean effective pressure. Because when we say that different engines like SI engines, like CA engines, like two-stroke engines, then four-stroke engines, like naturally aspirated engines, then turbocharged engines, the corresponding design of these engines is based on a certain, you know, BMEP, you know, they have a certain range of BMEP as per experience, because of experience, you know, they have a range. That means if you take the mean of that range, that is this constant, you know. Similarly, you know, out of the, you know, brake mean effective pressure. Therefore, you know, if you are talking of the brake mean effective pressure, we could be talking about the indicated mean effective pressure. Indicated mean effective pressure, you know, if you have a PV diagram, the PV diagram based on the cylinder and the piston itself, that could give you the indicated mean effective pressure. Then after removing this frictional mean effective pressure, FMEP, you could get the, you know, brake mean effective pressure. So what we can do is, we can start from indicated mean effective pressure corresponding to a PV diagram and corresponding to the indicator diagram. After knowing indicated mean effective pressure, then if somehow we are able to get the friction mean effective pressure, you subtract, then you get the BMEP or brake mean effective pressure. Then, you know, the total motor friction mean effective pressure. total friction, this is only friction, you know, that means this includes the gas exchange and other rubbing type of friction. In terms of bar, or the units are bar here, you know, there could be kilopascals also, this is bar here, 0.97 plus this one, n by 1000 plus 0.05 n by 1000. This thermodynamic modeling based equation is there, which help us to calculate or compute the total motor friction mean effective pressure, which includes the friction for the accessories, the friction for the engine components having a relative motion between them, and the gas exchange part of the engine itself. Then motor means modeling, from the modeling point of view and from the experiment point of view, what we are trying to do is we are running the engine by means of a motor. You know, the motor is directly coupled with the engine crankshaft. The motor drives the crankshaft, and when the motor drives the crankshaft will move the piston up and down. You know, the power transmission is from the crankshaft to the piston. There is no firing, there is no combustion. That is what is known as motor. Motor means we use a motor to study the engine friction in terms of the work or power needed for gas exchange, intake and exhaust process. Then friction between components having a relative motion between them. Then friction involved in for power transmission for many engine accessories. This is applicable to four-stroke, four-cylinder SI engine having a displacement in the range of 845 cc's to 2000 cc's at wide open throttle. And here, n is the engine crankshaft rotational speed. This equation directly tells you, when you change the engine crankshaft rotational speed, the total motor friction mean effective pressure does change. That means, in thermodynamics, we have a combustion modeling. We have corresponding to the, heat release rate and theta diagram, or corresponding PV diagram for combustion for SI engines, for combustion for CI engines. Then we have the heat release rate models, the Vibe model, single zone model, the Vibe two zone model, how heat is released per unit of time or per degree of crank angle. The heat release rate, these are known as combustion models or heat release rate models. Then there are heat transfer models for the engine. This is part of the engine friction modeling. Engine friction modeling is here. There are heat transfer models. There are combustion models. And likewise, there could be many more models there. Like NOC model is here. How to study the phenomena of NOC in engines. All these concepts, like friction-based mean effective pressure, like heat transfer, they have been modeled thermodynamically in terms of various parameters, which are somehow concerned with engine only, or which are somehow related to engine only. Reducing the total friction mean effective pressure by about 10 kilopascals. I was telling you here using the units of bar. This could be a kilopascals here also by conversion. Reducing the total friction mean effective pressure by about 10 kilopascals. This results in improvement in fuel consumption by 2%. This is one more method of designing an engine for better mileage. Better mileage by virtue of the definition of thermal efficiency, by virtue of the definition of BSFC, does mean that the corresponding thermal efficiency will also rise. Then you have speed here, and you have FMEP here, friction mean effective pressure, with one more different unit, atmosphere is now here. Then you are able to plot it here. Friction mean effective pressure under motored conditions at wide open throttle for several four-cylinder spark ignition engines. Wide open throttle does mean full load. It does mean full load. Then one more graph, the mechanical efficiency of the engine. Say 100% efficiency could be here 1.0, which is not there. The maximum efficiency could be something like 90% mechanical efficiency. Then this is percentage load towards 100% load and towards part load operation of the engine. Then one more graph, this is pumping mean unit pressure means the gas exchange. Pumping mean unit pressure divided by the total frictional mean unit pressure. The ratio of the two, these graphs are there. Basically, we are able to plot these graphs so that we could think how we could minimize the frictional loss or frictional power of the engine, or work to be done in order to overcome the engine friction, in order to go for more efficient engines in terms of the performance, just like this one, which could improve the fuel consumption by 2%. The fuel consumption does get reduced by 2% here. When you plot these graphs, the interpretation of these graphs, they help you in understanding the various aspects of engines, and then only when you are at the research level, you can think more deeply how to do the things in a better manner. Pumping mean unit pressure corresponds to gas exchange, intake process and exhaust process, and R is FMEP, the rubbing. R stands for rubbing. Those components of the engine which have a rubbing action between them, like piston rings and the cylinder, like the any bearing and the corresponding shaft. Any shaft is mounted in the bearings or supported in the bearings. There is a rubbing type of thing between them. That means this is rubbing type of friction mean pressure. This is plotted here. Let me clarify here. The rubbing, rubbing friction MEP is here. This graph is here, and this graph is here. Pumping means gas exchange part. When you increase the load, BMAP is one more method of talking about the load. BMAP, in case of the basic engine design and operating parameters, when we defined BMAP, we said that the BMAP is maximum at a speed corresponding to maximum torque, and the BMAP is 10 to 15% lower at the speed corresponding to maximum power. Okay, corresponding to other torque positions and corresponding to the lower power positions, the corresponding BMAP will be lower. That means the load also will be lower, or corresponding power generation or torque being developed is also lower. So BMAP is one more method of the representation of the load on the engine or the power being developed by the engine, because load external to the engine should be equal to the power developed internal to the engine. This comes down and this goes up. Pumping work, pumping mean unit pressure, mean in terms of the mean unit pressure and rubbing friction mean unit pressure as a function of load here. That is what is load. BMAP is taken as a load here, because BMAP is ultimately at the crankshaft. The crankshaft basically overcomes the load. This data is for an engine having a compression ratio of 12, okay, and with the corresponding dimensions bore millimeters and stroke millimeters, and engine RPM is 1600 RPM. That previous a thermodynamic model based equation, or a thermodynamics based equation. This was for SI engine. Similarly, such modeling is done for CI engines also, so that we can do such things when we design softwares like AVL Boost or AVL Fire or Ricardo suit based software, or GT Power based software, or ANSYS type of software. When we have these thermodynamic equations available to us, then only we are able to develop a complete engine softwares for all purposes. And these softwares, they help you in the engine design and research. Then for diesel engines, we have a motoring MEP, mean pressure, in terms of with the units of kilopascals, represented by this equation, N divided by 1000 and SP bar square. N is RPM of the engine at the crankshaft. SP bar is in terms of mean piston speed. This is then square is here, square is here, not here. SP bar is mean piston speed with the units of meter per second. Then for different types of engines like direct injection diesel engines, 75 kPa C1. Then for indirect injection diesel engines, the corresponding value of C1 is 110 for large swirl based engines. Then again, no, again for motor total friction meter pressure with the units of kilopascals on the y-axis and engine speed on the x-axis, we are able to plot a graph for understanding the corresponding friction as a function of speed of the engine. That means when you increase the engine speed, the corresponding friction that increases, or frictional power increases, power or friction MEP increases. The corresponding unit has to be considered. This we can say the friction type of load, the friction type of load does increase. One load is external to the engine, the internal to the engine, something like frictional work to be done or frictional power to be overcome, that type of load. Or resistance, like electrical resistance, the friction in mechanical is mechanical resistance. It's mechanical resistance. Then one more graph is here, pumping MEP, that is gas exchange one, as a function of main piston speed. Then this curve here, this graph here, this curve line is corresponding to 0.4 times SP bar square. This is not for the simply SP. This is not simply for SP. This curve is corresponding to the conversion of this one. Whatever unit you have, whatever value you have for SP, SP bar, main piston speed, then you take a square of that, again you multiply by 0.4, then you get this graph, okay? You take any value on the main piston speed line, then you take a square of that, okay? Then you multiply further that by 0.4, you get this graph. I have forgotten to plot some points here, given in the book. Those points corresponded to something like a PMEP, okay? Those I have forgotten to plot here. I have plotted only one line, but this line corresponds to this type of conversion. Pumping mean unit pressure as a function of mean piston speed for several naturally aspirated diesel engines. From the book point of view, this is an incomplete graph. Engine friction components, motored engine breakdown test. Let us see what is that. Motored engine test, where the engine is disassembled for broken down in stages, can be used to determine the friction associated with each major engine assembly. Breakdown test means a motored engine breakdown test. Motored means somehow without combustion, we want to move the various engine components. We want to activate the valve train, that whatever valve mechanism is there, whatever valve activating mechanism is there, somehow we want to move it to calculate or understand the friction, or we want to understand the friction between the piston rings and the cylinder, or the friction between the bearings, different types of bearings, small end bearing, big end bearing, main bearings, and the camshaft bearings, and the corresponding shaft, the camshaft or the crankshaft. We take power for that by using an electrical motor, and then we can disassemble the engine component wise, and somehow give a motion, and somehow we should be able to evaluate the engine friction component wise. That is what is known as breakdown test. By means of a motion being given to the components by using things like motors, and not the combustion based motion. A contribution from the piston assembly, piston rings, including the compression rings, with the valve train, crankshaft bearings, and water and oil pump, all making a significant contribution to the total. That means in case of the engine friction components, we have already studied the engine friction components. Those components are there, where they have a relative motion between them, then engine accessory based components, okay. Then a third component was there, which was basically gas exchange. And in case of the mechanism based components, where there was a relative motion, you can disassemble the engine component wise. Maybe it is possible to study the valve train separately. Maybe it is possible to study the piston and rings and cylinder separately. Maybe it is possible to study the crankshaft and main bearing separately. Maybe it is possible to study the camshaft and its corresponding bearing separately. And for all these drives, for all these mechanisms, the drive could be a motor, you know, and not the combustion. You can take the camshaft along with the bearing separately. You can take the crankshaft with its bearing separately. You can take the piston and a cylinder and its rings separately. And a corresponding drive could be a motor. The drive could not be achieved by means of combustion in the cylinder. And we are able to study the engine friction component wise. That is what was, you know, described here as engine breakdown test. This one. When we are able to give a you know slight motion to a component, like in case of the Maruti Suzuki 800cc car engine, when you are able to generate power just to keep the engine running without putting the vehicle into gear, that means the engine is not being loaded as yet, but the piston is moving up and down, the crankshaft is rotating, the corresponding idle RPM is 900 plus minus 50, then corresponding power being developed by the engine is just as slightly more than the frictional power of the engine, slightly more than that. But we see that the corresponding power being developed by the engine is just equal to the frictional power of the engine. That's why he said here, that means under idle RPM conditions, the corresponding, you know, frictional power is 100%. Actually, the power being developed by the engine has to be slightly more than that. You know, they should not get balanced. Balancing the two powers, you know, it should be slightly more than that so that it gives a motion. You could be having so many research papers, you know, research publications at the end of this chapter in the book by John B. Haywood, which could lead you to the methods, how they have disassembled the engine component wise, and how people have been able to understand or get the numerical values of the corresponding engine friction component wise. In actual industries, in actual automotive industries, in actual R&D centers, how exactly they have dismounted the engine, how they have disassembled the engine components, how they have achieved the calculations for the engine friction component wise. This you can get from research papers only. Then so far as rubbing and accessory friction breakdown is concerned, breakdown means the corresponding breakdown, breakup. And what is breakup? Sometimes in terms of the syllabus also we say what is the breakup of questions for the exam. The breakup here is piston assembly, that means piston rings and cylinder, you know, that contributes 50%, valve train 25%, crankshaft bearings 10%, accessories 15%. This is not arbitrary. This they have calculated on the basis of breakdown of the component. Breakdown means disassemble the engine component wise, somehow move the components in the same manner as they move in the engine with same speed and load conditions, and then you are able to compute the corresponding friction. We stop here today. If you have questions, you can ask. More details you can see in the book by John B. Haywood.